As many of you know, the State Department is ACYPL's foremost partner in their exchange work, and this is the 10th State Department-supported town hall since ACYPL pivoted to virtual. My name is Catherine Gunter, and in addition to being today's moderator, I am the Director of State Affairs at Oracle and a very proud ACYPL alum. I had the privilege of traveling to China in June 2019, and on my exchange, I was lucky enough to spend 3 days with our panelists to celebrate the 40th anniversary of exchanges between ACYPL and the All China Youth Federation. So as a new administration takes over in DC, there's been a lot of discussion around what diplomacy will look like under the new Secretary of State, Anthony Blinken, and the Biden administration. Conversations are swirling around US-China relations, as well as trade in North America, and most recently news out of the Middle East, where four countries have normalized relations with Israel. To learn a little bit more about the tone and tenor that American diplomacy could take, I am honored to introduce our distinguished panelists so that they can share their insights on this important topic. So today we have ACYPL trustee and former ambassador to Morocco, Dwight Bush, and ACYPL alum and former ambassador to Nepal, Julia Chang Bloch. So as I mentioned, Ambassador Bloch served as the US ambassador to Nepal under President George H.W. Bush. And upon assuming this role, she became the first US ambassador of Asian descent. Julia is a founding president of the US-China Education Trust, which promotes educational exchanges to nurture the next generation of leaders in the US and China. She traveled with ACYPL to China in 1977 and then returned again for the 40th anniversary in 2019. So we're excited to have her with us. And then secondly, we have Ambassador Bush, who served as the US ambassador to Morocco under President Barack Obama. He was the first diplomat inducted into the US Chamber of Commerce and Morocco Hall of Fame and received a State Department Distinctive Honor Award. Dwight currently serves as the CEO of DL Bush and Associates, and which is a strategy and business advisory firm that helps companies and investors with projects in the Middle East, North Africa, and US. In addition, Ambassador Bush currently serves on the board of ACYPL, Goldman Sachs Mutual Fund Trust, the Middle East Investment Initiative, and the National U.S. Arab Chamber of Commerce, among other organizations. He is the Emeritus Trustee of Cornell University and was previously Director of Santander Bank USA. So as you all can see, we are in for such a treat. Ambassador Bloch and Bush, we are so happy to have you with us, and I'm excited to see you both again. So let's just get started. So the first question we have for you today is just for the audience. The State Department is made up of three different types of employees. We have civil service, foreign service, and what is called political or a non-career appointee, usually meaning an ambassador outside of foreign service that's been appointed by the president. So since both of you were political appointees, can you speak a little bit to the strengths and weaknesses that being non-career afforded you as ambassadors? Ambassador Bloch, let's start with you.
Thank you very much, Catherine. And I'm delighted to be here with ACYPL and our audience. Welcome to you all. Great to have you, but I wish I could see you. Well, before I get into the strengths that non-career ambassadors like Dwight and myself bring to our positions, I think our audience needs to understand that much of the career service and the foreign policy establishment consider such appointments as a disservice to US diplomacy and foreign policy interests. They believe that the appointment of the likes of Dwight and me undermines sometimes US standing and influence in the international community because they subscribe to the conventional caricature of the political ambassador, a fat cat donor who is clueless and brainless, just enjoying the spoils of patronage. There has been a flood of studies and recommendations that have greeted the new Biden administration on how to repair and restore the diplomatic corps. Well, a key recommendation is to cap non-career ambassadors at 10%. The norm has been around 30%, and under Trump, a little bit more. So let me just quote you to give you that sense of what the establishment thinks. The wreckage at the State Department runs deep. Career diplomats have been systematically sidelined and excluded from senior Washington jobs on an unprecedented scale. The picture overseas is just as grim. With the record quantity of political appointees serving as ambassadors, matched by their often dismal quality, and I unquote. An ambassador recommending the 10% cap wrote, in my experience, and I quote, every political appointee named to an ambassador comes at the expense of a career officer, especially career female officers, period. Now to answer your question. So it was not really a huge surprise to me that I would be tested by the embassy staff when I arrived in Nepal. And I was forewarned by a senator at a send-off dinner before my departure. So on my first day in my Kathmandu office, I looked around the room and I didn't see a computer. So I called up the admin officer and asked about a computer. And she blithely responded to me that there were none available because the last one had been assigned to the family liaison officer. I couldn't believe my ears. And so I just looked at her and said, well, go find the newest computer in the embassy and have it installed at my desk immediately. She only hesitated a moment. And then she finally said, yes, ma'am. I have many more stories to tell, but time is moving on, and I need to get to the strengths of non-career ambassadors, because Dwight and I, I should say Ambassador Bush and I, do have some strengths. I would start with the fact that not all career ambassadors are good, and not all non-career ambassadors are bad. In my case, unlike career ambassadors, I was not confined to the strictures of the State Department, as I had already worked for more than 20 years in the US Senate, the Peace Corps, the US Information Agency, and USAID at relatively high positions. I understood how Washington works, and I was willing to take risks to get the job done. In Nepal, after the revolution, I never thought twice about working with the communists, which had become the opposition party and an important part of the government. My residence in Kathmandu became the only place in town where Nepalese and of all political stripes gathered. One of the few official missives that I received from Washington reminded me to be careful with the communists for fear that then conservative and powerful Senator Jesse Helms, if you're old enough to remember, then you may be nearer to my generation than not. But they were very much afraid of Senator Jesse Helms, who would become the chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee in the Senate a few years later. Well, I did not think, frankly, that Senator Helms would take notice of Nepal, and he did not. So I end my story there, and I know that Ambassador Bush has a lot more to say about this subject.
Yes, absolutely. Let's take it over to Ambassador Bush. Okay.
Well, thank you, Catherine. Thank you, ACYPL, for having me with you today. Ambassador, it's always good to be with you. I'd like to make a couple of observations on this issue because I think it is really important. The first is that when I became an ambassador, I was blown away by the quality of the colleagues that I had who were career foreign service officers. Their depth of knowledge, their understanding of the mission, our shared vision, their support of the president's agenda were all very compelling to me. And I really found it interesting that over more than 3 years that I was ambassador, I never came to work and felt that my colleagues were political, whether they were Republicans or Democrats. They were really focused on mission. And for that, I will always appreciate them and the job that they did. The question on the table is actually a pretty interesting one, because I do think that there are some differences between how career ambassadors approach their jobs and how non-career ambassadors approach the job. Just to give you perspective on my life and career, I think I've been very fortunate in that in my work, I've visited over 95 countries. I'm close to 100, and I plan to get there soon, first of all. Secondly, that I've been involved in some quasi-diplomatic organizations over the years. I was on the board of Gavi for 10 years. And Gavi, as you may know, is a global association of vaccines and immunizations, and they vaccinate 100 million children a year around the world. And the construct of the board looks a lot like the construct that you may see at a UN type of organization. So from that perspective, I felt that I was grounded, if you will, in some of the nuances of diplomacy. I think that there's one significant difference in how non-career and career diplomats approach the job of being an ambassador. And that is, as leaders, how we think about taking risk. I found that with most of my career colleagues, and this certainly showed at evaluation time, they were very focused on making sure that there were words in the document that the appraisals that we had to complete, because those were important for their movement up in the State Department. But if you read the documents are constructed in a very risk-averse way. And I believe that over time, the willingness and ability to take risk is a differentiator between non and careers. And let me give you a quick example. When I was an ambassador, I was lucky that we completed a brand new embassy. And when I was walking through the embassy building with the head of state for Morocco, he noticed that there was very little that reflected Moroccan culture in the building. And so I immediately asked my office manager to put in some zilage and to put in some towel work and do some other things that would reflect that important relationship that we had with Morocco. Of course, this caused quite an uproar in the State Department, because you're not supposed to touch a building for 3 years. And so when I was back in Washington, I was asked to come and see the offices of building management, where they really felt compelled to give me a dressing down. And so I walked into a room, I brought the beautiful pictures from the changes that we had made to the building. I showed them anecdotally the comments that were on our YouTube page from people who had visited and loved what we had done, and they applauded the change. And then I said, mea culpa. As a leader of this embassy, I felt compelled to do this, and I asked my people to make these changes. Now, and so then all of the tension left the room and we were all fine. I tell you the story to suggest that I think it would be the rare career diplomat who in the moment would make the decision to take the risk and do something different. So that's the main differentiator that I see. We're equal professionals. We all took our jobs very seriously, but this one additional thing around leadership and the risk that you take to be a successful leader, I think is a differentiator. And frankly, I think there should be more non-career ambassadors than fewer.
That's great. And I think that's really interesting, especially speaking to culture. And it's a good segue into our next question. The Foreign Service is typically what people think of when they think of the State Department. These are employees posted around the world representing the US. But something that has kind of come to the forefront is that the Foreign Service, especially at some of these senior levels, as you mentioned, Ambassador Bush, it's not reflective of the broader diversity within the US. So I'm just curious if both of you have thoughts on what institutional changes could be made to kind of help combat this. Ambassador Bloch, why don't we start with you?
Before I answer your question, I would like to pose a question for Ambassador Bush to think about. You know, you were not tested at all by your staff. I wonder whether the difference in the treatment of the two of us has to do with race or gender. think about
that? Well, I would say that it's certainly, I think, a reflective of the different time when we served.
Different times, exactly.
As ambassadors. I think that I would tell you that on both of the other points, I have friends who were ambassadors from different diverse communities and were men and women, and they had, I think, equivalent experiences. So I think that the State Department has matured over the years. The thought that someone would think it would be more appropriate for my assistant to have a computer than for me to have one is just, it's appalling on many levels. But I think that the organization has matured in a way that embraces the strengths and appreciation for all diplomats.
Glad to hear that. And that's a great segue to diversity in the Foreign Service. I would start by saying that the lack of diversity in our diplomatic corps is longstanding. Ever since I can remember, our diplomats have been characterized as pale, male, and Yale. Didn't you go to Yale, Ambassador Bush?
I went to Cornell, so same kind of thing.
Okay, every report on reforming the Foreign Service that I mentioned earlier urges a rigorous enhancement and commitment to having a foreign service that could look like America. Well, and these reports cite the percentages of African and Hispanic officers at their lowest level in over 20 years. Just 5% of Black officers and over 3.6% for Hispanic officers. Most of the reports, however, don't mention Asian Americans at all. Mm-hmm. To this day, Asian Americans, particularly Chinese Americans, suffer the perpetual foreigner syndrome. I don't know how many times I've been asked, but you speak terribly good English. And I thought to myself, how do I answer that? I'm American, so I should speak good English, right? Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, research has shown that a majority of Americans believe that Asian Americans are not loyal to America. And worse, that we may actually be spies. A majority of Americans. And I don't know if you know, but for many, many years, the State Department has had a rule of assignment restrictions. And study after study have found that these restrictions particularly apply to Asian American officers. And I never thought, to be honest, I would live to see the day when a Chinese American would become ambassador to China. President Obama proved me wrong and sent Gary Locke, former governor of Washington State, former commerce secretary, to China as ambassador. And he performed well and he completed his service with honor. So that's that. However, we should still remember that not until 2016 did the State Department do something about the assignment restrictions practice. They did not repeal it, but they allowed for an appeal. So if you are a victim of assignment restriction, you have the right to know why. That's as far as we've gotten. So what I would stress, that in making our diplomatic corps to better reflect American society, well then, we should not leave out Asian Americans, without which our commitment to diversity and inclusion, I think, can be called a sham.
You're here. Ambassador Bush, I'd love to get your opinion as well.
Well, you know, Ambassador, I think you're right on point, because in diplomacy, we need people from all backgrounds, all faiths, all regions, who can be effective at understanding cultural differences, social distances, nuances in conversation, nuances in approach to diplomacy and interaction. And so we benefit from having the most diverse community of diplomats that we can have. I think that, well, what I know is that there are a couple of things that need to be done. Number one is we need to encourage, we need to be at the university level, talking to people from broad backgrounds about foreign service. So when I was graduating from college, I was thinking about finance or going to law school. And even though I was a government major, I never thought about public service in the international sphere at that time. Knowing what I know today and knowing how I've been, my life has been enriched by spending a lot of time outside of the United States, I probably would have gravitated towards a career in public service had I known or had I been encouraged to do so. So first thing is that we have to be more visible in colleges and universities, whether it's historically Black colleges, state colleges and universities, et cetera, in talking about the opportunities on a focused basis to these different constituent groups. The second thing that has to take place is that in the State Department, there is a great need for better and more effective mentoring. I mean, I currently, even though I'm no longer there, have developed relationships with many lower and mid-level career professionals at state who are grappling with their positions and also with their perceived value to state. And even during the last 4 years, where a lot of foreign service officers became very concerned and have thought about leaving, I encourage them to stay, because we obviously need them and we need their skills. But also I hope that because of this, what's gone on, that some of them will be able to advance on an accelerated basis and they will move up, and that visibility will encourage others to stay. I'm so pleased to see that my good friend, Linda Thomas Grenfell, is at the United Nations representing us. So she is visible. And when young career professionals think about the art of the possible, they can look to her as the art of the possible. And I know the Secretary of State, I think, Tony Blinken is the ideal person, given his worldview, to take this need and make sure that we do the right things to make sure that our diplomatic corps represents the people of the United States. And I think with him and the president, we'll see some positive change.
Well, that's great to hear. And I certainly agree with you. Had I known the possibilities in college, I might have picked a different career path. ACYPL definitely opened my eyes to that. So this question is for Ambassador Bloch. I don't know if many Americans understand the value and skill that's needed to undertake diplomatic efforts. Can you talk about, and maybe an issue or a topic that you handled during your tenure in Nepal that embodies the best of diplomacy?
Oh, I'd be happy to. I arrived in Kathmandu in September of 1989. Were you born yet, Catherine?
I was 1 year old. I was alive.
Oh my God, I thought so. Oh, it's history, it seems. But I arrived at a momentous moment in Nepal's history, because beginning in January 1990, the Nepalese underground parties set aside their differences, historic, long differences, and united to overthrow their absolute monarch, inspired by the revolutions then occurring across Eastern Europe. In early April, the armed police protecting the palace opened fire against the crowds marching against the king, killing dozens. I witnessed Nepal's revolution and its transformation from an absolute monarchy to multi-party democracy. Because in November of 1990, King Birendra of Nepal put his official seal on a new constitution that enshrined multi-party democracy and human rights as hallmarks of Nepal's political system. Asked for advice by the king during the revolution through an intermediary who became a friend of mine, I had no instructions from Washington, but my immediate response to this intermediary was that the king would be on the right side of history if he could settle the differences in peace with no more violence. I mean, simple as that. I don't know what impact my response had exactly, but a few days later, King Birendra agreed to legalize political parties, appointed an interim prime minister, and created a cabinet from left and center Nepalese parties. So through the process, no Americans were hurt. We had about 25 to 30,000 American tourists in Nepal at that time. And there was no recrimination, as the US officially congratulated King Birendra as the constitutional monarch and all the political parties as the US, you know, as the US would, including the communists, for Nepal's transition to democratic rule. And throughout, America played the honest broker, and we continued to do so. We were able to do so with the interim government, supporting their drafting of the constitution, as well as the planning and preparation for the election that was successfully held in 1991. I would say that was my proudest moment.
Yeah, I'll say.
when the elections concluded with a freely elected government. But I have to say, unfortunately, that the story doesn't end there. Because 3 years after I left Nepal, 1996, the communists took up arms and started a decade-long civil war, which killed thousands. Nepal is again at peace, but the country has not advanced economically very much. It's tough to be a democracy. What can I say?
That is true. But I think that effort it's amazing, and those stories need to continue to be shared, the work that diplomacy can do. We're gonna pivot over to Ambassador Bush. Morocco has been in the news quite a bit recently, especially after the December agreement to normalize relations with Israel, which also included the US recognition of Morocco's sovereignty over the Western Sahara. Can you speak to your experience navigating some of these thorny issues, and if you anticipate a change of policy with the new Biden administration?
Yeah. Well, first, if I think we have enough time to do this, I want to spend just a little time on the question that you just asked the ambassador about the diplomacy, because I think it's really important. So from my perspective, diplomacy is more of an art and then it is a science. And then if you think about it, you have people trying to come together to resolve issues, to move forward on agendas. And each party brings to that discussion a history, a culture, the reality of their constituents, what they're trying to achieve, what a good outcome looks like. And so along the way, you're balancing all of these to come to a reconciliation. So let me give you an example of one thing that happened while I was in Morocco and how soft diplomacy was used to resolve the issue. So when I was there, there was a human rights report disagreement between my colleagues in Washington, DC, and my colleagues in New York at the UN. And of course, we had a point of view in Morocco, in Rabat as well. And this became quite a kerfuffle, if you will, in Morocco, because the Moroccans felt that they had committed so much to improving their institutions over a period of time. And their view was that the United States was not really appreciating what it had done. And even when there were isolated instances of things that went wrong, they felt that we were attributing that to institutional shortcomings. And so there was a disagreement. It was in the press. I was asked to come to see them, foreign minister, et cetera. Well, this all occurred during the Ramadan, right before the Ramadan season. And I concluded that the way I could diffuse this issue was to use some social diplomacy to show something. And so I invited a young internet celebrity chef to my home. His name was Chef Omar. He had special needs, but he had quite a big following. So I asked him to come over so that we could prepare a Ramadan dinner together. So he came to my house, we go into the kitchen, we prepare a meal. And along the way, I'm telling him certain things. For example, I said, Chef Omar, I know you want to be a chef, but it's really important to me that you complete your education. Will you commit to that? He said, yes, Mr. Ambassador. And so we continued to talk. And I said, Chef, who's been the biggest influence in your life? He said, well, my mom encouraged me to be a chef and to cook. And I said to him, that's really good. Now, Chef Omar, you have to promise to me that you will always be respectful to your mom, and you will also always be kind because she encouraged you to develop this passion. And so he committed to that. So we sit down to have our Ramadan dinner, and I turn to him, I say, you know, Chef Omar, there are a lot of things that take people apart, but there are some things like a good meal and a good conversation that can bring us together. And working together, we can resolve anything. Well, it blows up on YouTube. 700,000 people end up watching the video. And I am summarily asked to come back to the Foreign Ministry of Morocco, where we sit down and we resolve this issue. So it's really an art. And you really have to think about all the tools that you have to reach the outcomes that you want. Now, the issue specifically around the Alhambra Accords is very interesting because there are a couple of things that have gone on here, and there is a need for a background. The first piece of the background is that the Alhambra Accords is a three-party agreement between the United States and Israel and several Muslim countries, of which Morocco just became one. There is a long history in the relationship between Morocco and Israel. And indeed, many of the people at the forming of Israel actually are Jews from Morocco. So the relationship has been rich and ongoing, and there is a natural reason for this. The second thing that people need to appreciate is that the Sahara was controlled by colonialists for a little bit more than 100 years. When Spain left, they abdicated the responsibility for operations over a governance of the Sahara to the Moroccans. There has been tension since that time because there's a view of some, the Polisario, for example, which is a group aligned with Algeria, that piece of real estate should be controlled independently by the Sahrawi people, which are one of the tribes that comprised Morocco before it was colonized. And this dynamic has been going on for quite a while. In the late 60s, there was an agreement that was started to be reached that between the Moroccans, the Algerians, the Polisario, the Sahrawis, regarding the disposition of the Sahara. And in the beginning of the 20th century, under former Secretary Baker, there was progress made. There was a realization that the Moroccan autonomy plan was probably the best place to negotiate a peaceful outcome that the plan was serious, realistic, and credible. So what you see happened in December actually is a part of a continuation that started in the 1990s that has continued. And I think that it is inevitable that the position on Moroccan sovereignty will stand. And it will stand because of some practical and pragmatic reasons. Number one, the Moroccans are indeed a long-term historic relationship for the United States. First country to recognize our independence in 1777. We have a very broad and comprehensive diplomatic relationship. Number two, from a geopolitical and real estate perspective, if you will, there are questions about if Morocco were not the sovereignty over the region, the void would likely be filled by Al-Qaeda members or other disenfranchised and terrorist organizations. And remember that Morocco is about a 15-minute boat ride from the Mediterranean Europe points. So I think that we have shared interests in seeing this sovereignty there. I think that the relationships are important between Morocco and Israel and the United States. And my hope is that the Biden administration will continue to make progress to ensure that that the Sahara remains a stable place to be.
That's very interesting. And I love getting the background as I didn't know the area and I didn't know the history as well. So I really appreciate you taking the time to do that. So we're gonna switch gears and I'm gonna ask both of you a question. So as you know, ACYPL is filled with a network of elected officials at the city, county, and state levels. With the lack of foreign policy consensus between administrations these days, what role do you see for these subnational actors like governors and mayors in the grand stage of American diplomacy? And we'll start actually, Ambassador Bush, with you. Yeah.
Sure. I would be pleased to, because I think this is really important. And certainly, again, I think about these from my experience with Morocco and what I see continuing. I'm aware that there are groups like the mayor groups, governors, organizations, people from the judicial community who go and provide leadership and support around policy work, helping to ensure there's advancement on things like civil liberties, the rights of women, et cetera. At the ground level, they actually engage in a piece of diplomacy that's really, really important, which is helping to ensure adherence to good principles of governance at the local levels, at the state levels, thinking through concepts around budgets, about the rights of people in the regions. And it gives, at a very granular level, the State Department is a great policy-oriented organization, but we all know that a lot of work gets done at the grassroots level, and anything that we can do to encourage that engagement has to be a net profit for both us and the countries that are important to us.
Well, Catherine, you alluded to the fact that with so much gridlock at the national level, I think our mayors and governors have become more and more active in international affairs. But traditionally, governors and mayors have led trade delegations all over the world to sell their products, so to speak. And now it's so hot, this diplomacy at the subnational level, it has its own name. It's called para-diplomacy. And it's most active in the climate arena. California, for example, has led the way with reducing carbon emissions and signing agreements with all kinds of states, other foreign states. And since we got out of the Paris Accord, our subnational level officials have created the United States Climate Alliance, 30 governors, because they refused to abandon the Paris Accord's principles. And nearly 400 mayors endorsed the agreement. So I see this as really a growth industry. and there will be more and more opportunities. For example, because of globalization, we're so interconnected now. There are public health issues, transportation, sanitation, tourism, people-to-people exchange. They all have something to do with local officials. And I see opportunities everywhere. And let me throw out something that Dwight or Ambassador Bush mentioned in his earlier comments about really soft diplomacy. For those who are maybe in the audience who represent the food industry or an agricultural county or state or locality, I can't think of anything better than what Dwight talked about, and that's culinary diplomacy. I didn't do that in Nepal, but I've done that a lot with China. And it is something that attracts everyone. Food brings people together. And you can do that a lot better at the local level than at the national level. I guess we can say that hamburgers are Americans' national dish, but we have so much more at the at the regional local levels. I mean, I can think of a field day of, I mean, God, Louisiana gumbo. What fried chicken, Southern fried chicken? I mean, I'm thinking more and more about the South, but everywhere. I mean, you make all kinds of breads, you know, from the wheat producing sections of the country. I mean, there are no end of ideas. All you have to have is imagination and some resources. So I would say ACYPL, you know, alumni with that kind of a background, go for it.
Yeah, I love the idea of culinary diplomacy. It's one of my favorites. I think we all got to embrace that when we were in China together. Speaking of exchanges, you know, Ambassador Bloch, I would just love to get your sense as you're with your role as the U.S.-China Education Trust, you work to promote stronger and stable relations between the two countries. With Biden administration's Asia coordinator, Kirk Campbell, he said that the goal in Asia is now to shore up international order as a counterbalance to China. Would just love to get your thoughts on that, if you think that's an achievable goal and what you think could be a good path forward.
Well, Kirk Campbell just got off of the U.S.-China Education Advisory Council because of his new position. And he is a respected Asia hand, and he's written and said so many things about the region, particularly about China. I would say that Kurt's goal in Asia, more broadly, the Indo-Pacific, will be for the U.S. to be more than just a counterbalance to China. In his more recent writings, one article written with National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan, now his boss, they stressed the need for clear-eyed coexistence between the two powers. And in his latest article written with Rush Doshi of Brookings, they called for building a durable and flexible balance of power in Asia. I think Kurt's thinking now is much more to emphasize a balanced approach, and he recognizes that it is neither practical nor possible to exclude Beijing from Asia's future, just to counter Beijing. The countries in the region would not want to be forced to choose between the two superpowers. And China will have a place in the region, in the regional order, whether we like it or not. And Kurt has stated that he envisions Chinese membership in the order's primary institution, the regional order's primary institutions, that we have to find ways to cooperate with the Chinese government, as we cannot solve transnational threats like climate change or future pandemics alone. Having said that, this means, of course, that the U.S. must at the same time re-energize our allies, alliances, and bridge European and regional approaches to the Chinese challenges. So I can't think of a more difficult job than President Biden's. And I have to say that we have to find a solution, because in my view, the US-China relationship is the most consequential relationship in the 21st century. Without our resolving our, at least decide, let's say, or at least work towards some commonality, I think the world is in trouble.
I agree. I think those are, we should heed your advice, excuse me. So we so appreciate both of your time today and getting to know and talk a little bit more in depth. We're going to switch it up a little bit. As I mentioned, when I started this whole thing, we were all lucky enough to spend some time in Beijing together, and I got to know you both on a more personal level. So to close out today's discussion, I was hoping you guys would do a couple lightning round questions so that everyone watching can get a better sense of your personalities and get to know you both better. Does that sound okay? All right. Let's start with Ambassador Bush. We'll go with you first. What are you reading right now?
So I'm reading The Man Who Ran Washington, Peter Baker's book about James Baker. And it's a fabulous read. Secretary Baker had a huge influence on Washington, D.C., on foreign policy and domestic policy in his different roles for an extended period of time. I've had the chance to spend some time with Secretary Baker. He is, he's a great American, a great patriot. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad my book club decided to choose this book at this time of year.
Oh, I love that. All right, Ambassador Bloch, what are you reading right now?
Well, I'm reading The Last Kings of Shanghai by Jonathan Kaufman. It's about the Baghdadi Jews and what they built in pre-war, World War II Shanghai. And it's a very engrossing read. And the US-China Education Trust is probably going to do a book launch around his writings.
Fantastic. I'm gonna have to give both of these books to my book club. It'll be a change of pace for them. So let's go back to Ambassador Bush. What is the best piece of advice that you've ever received?
The best piece of advice I received was from my father, who said, do the best you can with what you have every day. Nobody can ask you to do more than you're capable of doing, but it's upon you to figure out how much capacity you have.
I love that. Ambassador Bloch, we'll take it to you. Same question.
Same as Ambassador Bush. Shortly after arriving off the boat in San Francisco from China, my father pulled me aside, I'm the eldest, and said, now you're in America, don't look back, as we're not going back. Try harder, work more, do better. And whatever comes your way, do your best. And a year later, when I was running for class president, my father told me, you've become an American already. Remember to be humble.
Both are great and things that we should all take into consideration moving forward. All right, so back to you, Ambassador Bush. What is your drink of choice?
My drink of choice is vodka on the rocks with a twist, because vodka has the fewer number of calories. And so I can manage my weight and I can justify drinking vodka because it's a low-cal option.
Yeah, it's a skinny cocktail. That's all good.
That's right.
Ambassador
Bloch. And it's not complicated.
No, it's not. You can't screw that up. Ambassador Bloch, same question. It could be whatever.
No, mine is very boring. I guess I would say a glass of white wine or Prosecco.
That's not boring at all. I thought you were going to say water. I was like, that would be boring.
No.
All right. And the last one, Ambassador Bush, if your life was a movie, what would you call it?
The movie would be The Godfather's Wonderful Life.
Oh.
Because it's a combination of my two favorite movies, The Godfather and It's a Wonderful Life. In The Godfather, I learned a lot about the principles of being successful in business and in governance and getting things done. And in It's a Wonderful Life, you're taught to be humble, to appreciate what you have, to understand where you come from, and again, to do the best that you can.
I love that. And I just watched The Godfathers during the quarantine, so I'm fully versed now on how to get things done. Ambassador Bloch, what would your movie be titled?
I guess it would really be an immigrant's story.
Mm-hmm.
Because that really kind of says it all about my life.
Yeah. I mean, quite a story. You both are so distinguished. So I just, you know, I'm gonna close out now. So thank you so much to the panelists, ambassadors Julia Chang Bloch and Dwight Bush, for your time and your thoughtful answers. I think we had a great conversation and it was very fun. So just as a for the viewers, as we transition, and by we I mean ACYPL, to our virtual work, it's crucial to measure the impact of these types of sessions for our partners, including the State Department. So to do this, I'm asking all of the audience members to complete a brief exit survey. So if you're watching via Zoom, it'll show up on the screen after and you'll get an email tomorrow. You can avoid the survey. And if you're viewing via Facebook or YouTube, the link is in the video description. So thank you in advance. It really does do a lot of good for the work that ACYPL is doing. And finally, before we close, since the last time we were all together, we were in Beijing, I thought it would be appropriate to acknowledge that today is the start of the Chinese New Year, the Year of the Ox. So that is hard work, positivity, and honesty. So I wish those to both the ambassadors and to everyone watching. So Happy New Year, and thank you to everyone.
Looking forward to celebrating. Thank you, Catherine.
We should all have a drink.
That's right.
Okay.
I have water.
I have sparkling water. Vodka for all, right?
That's right. Thank you.
Thanks all.
Thank you.
Take care.
Bye.
Happy New Year.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.